everything that I know. Says I gotta go, tired of going solo. But I'm never gonna go there again. This is what it is. This is who I am. This is where I finally take my stand. I didn't wanna fall, but I don't have to grow. I'm not the one with two star hands. Giving him the best of everything that's left of the life inside this man. I've been born again.
Welcome, everyone. I'm so glad that I saw that red light wasn't on earlier today than after 30 minutes to an hour later, and you didn't have to do any fancy audio editing or anything.
I do want to say, I think the pre-show segment we did, I should tack that on the end of the show.
Oh, you should tack it on the end instead of the beginning. Well, maybe, yes. That'd be the hook. Make them hang on to the end. Oh, but, of course, with modern technology, they can fast forward. Just jump right to the end.
Yeah, well, it's all going to be good. I just like
We do. We stick it somewhere in the middle.
Yeah.
You know how Hannity does this, or Laura, a lot of these people, they'll do it. They say, you know, tonight, our special guest, Donald Trump, or our special guest, you name it, or on some other show, you know, tonight our special guest is, what's that girl's, that singer, that's the number one singer in the world.
Oh, I don't know.
Yeah, you know who she is. She, Kelsey's girlfriend.
Oh, Taylor Swift.
Taylor Swift. Taylor Swift tonight. You know, and then you're sitting there waiting for Taylor Swift, Taylor Swift, Taylor Swift. Mm. And then they throw her in, like, you know, not at the very end. Because, you know, you'll wait, won't watch, and you'll tune in at the end. But they'll throw it somewhere towards the end, you know, stuff like that.
Well, it's kind of like when Sean Hannity starts his radio show, he says, and coming up is so-and-so. And if he doesn't tell you this hour, it means wait until last segment of the third hour.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't tell you that.
Yep. He's the most notorious.
Oh, God.
So anyway.
Yeah.
Hey, let's start with the really weighty stuff today.
Oh, boy.
The BCS.
Oh, college sports.
Oh, man. Oh, man, they have really stepped in it this year.
Can I start out with a thesis, and then we'll prove it?
And then we'll go with the antithesis?
Okay. Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
The WWE has more honor than the NCAA, because the WWE at least admits that they're just entertainers. Whereas NCAA thinks they're about academic achievement.
Oh,
yeah.
Well, we're not even. Yeah, that's another whole story.
And prostitutes have more honor than the college presidents, because at least a prostitute who admits to being a prostitute has more honesty than the Power Five, who are all about prostituting themselves to TV contracts.
Well, yeah, but really, it's the bottom line. It's four letters, ESPN, or maybe three letters, ABC.
Yeah.
ABC essentially owns the NCAA.
Right. ESPN is a subsidiary of ABC, which is Disney.
Right.
Okay, Disney's doing this to college.
Right.
Yeah.
Because basically what has happened in the selection program or process, they have selected Michigan, which is legitimate win-wise, okay? Legitimately, if you go by their schedule and their wins, et cetera, they're undefeated.
They played three good teams.
Well, but they're undefeated.
Or two good teams.
They're undefeated.
Yeah.
In the Big Ten. Okay, they're a conference champion, undefeated. They beat their
Big Ten, which has two other good schools.
Right. So, nevertheless, they did that. Yeah. Okay. Well, the SEC, you could say the same thing. There's basically three good schools in the SEC.
Well, I can give you another stat.
Well, wait, let me finish my thought. Okay. But Michigan should not even be eligible because of the cheating scandal they had.
Oh, now there's another point.
Which they totally overlooked.
And admitted to.
Admitted to, and they're totally going to kick it down the road. In fact, the Big Ten Conference, other teams protested. That because they were videoing the other teams.
Practice, right?
Games. Okay. And the New York Jets or New England was doing it. They were stealing signals.
Yes.
So they knew it. They admitted it, everything. But nevertheless, no foul, nothing to see here, nothing to see here. We'll just let it kick it down the road. It's and they're going to let them play. In the way to punish them, you kick them out of the.
But, Eddie, it's worse than that. The NCAA hasn't even investigated them. It was the Big Ten that demanded that punishment.
Exactly. So that's what I'm saying. So the NCAA said, no, nothing to see here. So they're exactly. in. Okay, they're in.
Yes.
It should have been Ohio State. Shouldn't yep. have even been a question. They shouldn't even have been allowed to play in the championship game. They should have been in Knicks right from the beginning. Okay.
Okay.
They give their coach a 3-game suspension mm-hmm. and let the assistant coach come on. Okay.
Who saw the same stuff? Yeah, the whole team benefited from cheating.
Right.
They should all be ineligible.
So that's point one. Mm-hmm. Okay. Then you take Florida State, whose kids work hard all year, undefeated.
Yeah.
Did not lose a game. Mm-hmm. Okay. They did what they were supposed to do. They did what they were asked to do. Mm-hmm. Okay. They kicked them out. They take Texas that lost to Alabama.
No, they beat Alabama.
I'm sorry. They beat Alabama, but then they lost to OU.
One loss.
Right, yep. One loss. But then they had squeakers against three other schools.
Sure.
They almost lost to TCU.
Well, Alabama almost lost to Auburn. It probably should have.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So all of these teams that had all these squeakers, yeah. One-loss teams, mm-hmm. And the teams they lost to aren't even in the top 20. Yeah. I mean, they almost lost to. They're not even in the top 20.
Yeah.
Okay. Georgia goes through the whole season and loses to Alabama.
Right.
Okay. At the end. And I think someone was injured or something was wrong. So they jump Alabama up there. And then they leave Georgia out.
Yeah. I would agree.
The defending champion.
Yeah.
The defending NCAA champion.
I wouldn't go by that because TCU does is number two from last year, too. And that shouldn't count for anything.
No, but TCU didn't deserve it. TCU, their right. record, they lost to Texas Tech and Baylor, I think. I mean, they lost, what they have, they didn't even make it bowl eligible. And they're one of the teams that almost beat Texas.
Yeah, but that was last year. You shouldn't get awarded this year for last year's.
No, unless. It's your phone or my phone?
Oh, okay. Sorry.
It must be yours because mine's in the other room. I'm sure it's a kidnapping. But so, like I said, you reward it. Mm-hmm. I think you reward. If you're number one and you lose a game by 3 points in the last minute in a conference championship game to a team that lost to another team that's vying for the deal, that's also a one-loss team, mm-hmm. you give it to the defending champion. That's how I see it. And Alabama did not have a better, in fact, Alabama, I don't think, played teams with as good a schedule as Georgia did.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
here's
what I think happened. Here's what happened. Okay. And then I'll give you the floor, the flow. Okay. I'll give you the flow. Yeah. They were desperate to get Texas in there. That's what I think. Mm-hmm. They were desperate to get Texas in there because Texas was going to be the new SEC school. They, for some reason, are in love with Sarkisian, mm-hmm. who basically was fired from USC for being drunk on the sidelines. Mm-hmm. Came back and was at Alabama and now is finally taking Texas back. For some reason, I don't know what it is. For some reason, there's this inordinate love for Texas in the media.
Yeah.
And so they, because I could see it coming a mile away because they've been talking up Texas from the time they beat Alabama.
Yeah. I would agree with you that ESPN, the Disney Corporation, they're wanting to promote their brands. They've invested. They've got three big contracts out with SEC is probably their biggest.
Right.
Big 12 they just invested in, and they've always had
Big 12.
Yeah, that deal the Big 12 signed that all of a sudden just catapulted and killed the Pac-12.
Okay, that was Fox.
Yeah, it's a combination of Fox. in ESPN.
Yeah, but ESPN, still the big deal is Big Ten and SEC.
Right. That's what I'm getting to, is the three big labels that ESPN is invested in,
right,
are those three: Big Ten, Big 12, SEC. Okay. Right. So they want to promote their brand. They probably have the greatest control over the SEC.
Right.
Because SEC has allowed themselves to be so invested almost exclusively in ESPN.
Right. As well as the Big Ten. Those two.
Yeah, I'm saying.
Let me just throw this out there real quick. But see, I don't think they saw Texas any longer as a Big 12 school.
That's a good point. Yeah, it's all about moving forward and promoting.
Right.
Yeah. So what I'm saying is, at least with the contract the Big 12 did, they didn't give control over their league to just one media company.
Right.
And that's, you know, to their credit. Now, see, NBC still does some college sports. CBS still does some. But, you know, in fact, the Big 10 is diversified as well. CBS does less. But what I'm getting at here, what I wanted to help drive home your point about the SEC being overrated. This last year, against Power 5 conference opponents in other conferences, you know what their record is? 7-9.
Yeah.
They're losing against other conferences.
It was the same last year.
And you don't hear the media saying that.
No, they won't. They can't. It's like the Biden... PR team.
It's just like the Tulsa TV stations that won't talk about the gambling and addiction problems with their casinos. Now they're destroying families because they're on the take.
Yeah.
So what I'm getting at here, I would agree with you. If there's an SEC team that has the best argument, it's got to be Georgia.
Right. But then we left somebody out.
What?
Florida State.
I'm getting to
undefeated.
Yeah.
Go.
Right. Yeah. So I'm just saying, I'm just pointing out the problems with who they did choose first. Mm-hmm. And then let's look at who they didn't. So Texas has one loss. The crazy thing about human polling is we remember what happened last week and they let it weigh heavier than what happened last month. Bob Stoops always talked about it. A win early, a loss early in the season doesn't hurt you as bad, because human polling doesn't look at computers, treat all wins and losses all season long the same. And so, you know, while I'm glad to see a Big 12 team in there from a purely selfish point of view,
but they're not a Big 12 team. See, that's the thing that ticks me off.
I understand.
They're not really a Big 12 team anymore.
Yeah, I understand.
And that's
that.
Why they're in there. If they were still Big 12, they wouldn't be in there. I guarantee you, Georgia, it would be Georgia and Alabama.
Okay.
But I'm sorry, go ahead.
So if, the woulda, coulda, shouldas, you go into great detail. Now, I remember the arguments 20 years ago with Boise State. They would go undefeated, just clobbering everybody in the Mountain West. Now the WAC, or the Mountain. Yeah, it was the WAC back then. And, you know, and the argument was always, well, they don't play quality opponents. And finally, Bob Stoops scheduled a game with them, and Boise State beat them. Actually, that was a bowl game. Boise State.
Yeah,
and, you know, the craziness of all this, you know, It's turning into nothing but money, greed.
That's all it is.
And the argument that Florida State's been making, they made it last July. They said, we cannot compete on a national level on an even playing field because we don't get the money to build our programs like these other conferences. The ACC is really blowing it business-wise. Mm-hmm. And that does, but Florida State has proven, you know what? If we're really, really good, we can overcome that and still take on you guys.
And they were really good this year.
And yeah, but I don't think ESPN wants Florida State to have that platform to further expose the corruption of ESPN.
Yeah, there you go.
You know,
and sadly, this is the tragedy of it. The injury to their quarterback gave them an excuse.
It did, but it almost should have made the argument the other way. That even with a third string quarterback,
they ended up beating Tennessee?
No, Louisville.
Louisville, yeah.
Which who was great.
Louisville was undefeated, weren't they? Or were they had one loss. They had one loss. But, yeah. but again, they were a contender. 16th. Yeah, they were contender 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And now, obviously, we're coloring this in football terms, but the conference issue affects everything. And there is no conference as powerful in basketball as the Big 12. Do you know who the top two teams in the nation are right now? The rankings?
Texas and
Houston. And BYU. They just joined the Big 12 this year.
Yeah.
And you know where the perennial powerhouse Kansas is? They're like number 15 or 16.
Really? Yeah.
Yeah. It's a whole new game.
So it looks like somebody was pretty smart when they brought them into the Big 12, weren't they? Even though Houston's football team isn't that good.
And the Nostradamus, who a year ahead of time said, here's what you do, is really smart. You're welcome. That was my big claim to fame on it. But the cool thing about it, let's finish talking about the football thing because I want to go into more down the road.
Yeah. So, yeah, no, but Florida State, there's no reason Florida State should not be there. Mm-hmm. Okay. If you're going to go, see, if you're going to make rules, stick by the rules. Mm-hmm. This is Power Five conference, undefeated season. There were only four undefeated teams out of the Power Five.
And did it with a third of the money of the SEC,
you know,
Big Ten.
If they lose, they lose. I mean, that's just, you know, and you don't know if they're going to lose, right? Mm-hmm. So you don't stick your fair-haired. You know, here's what's funny. Do you remember when BCS first started, they decided the first 2 years they did it through the AP and the coaches' polls, and they put then they said, now we're going to let a computer do it. And the computer did it. And then, the sports writers and these people.
Yeah, they trashed it.
They didn't like it because they wanted the power.
Because they think they're smarter than the algorithms. Yeah.
So they went back to the coaches. But
well, it's every, a hybrid now.
Right. But every year that, it's the coaches that make the decision now. They go by that coach's final poll, and then the coaches. Well, then they get together and they choose.
The selection committee still, though, is some humans in a room.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
And so, but I remember when they let the computers a few years, the computer every year picked the right teams that would win it.
Well.
And so they should have stuck with the computers because the computers were right. But these pompous, you know, media people, they couldn't stand that.
In 2003,
early AI was already right.
The top two teams, let's see, USC was one of them. I'm trying to remember who the other, but the third and fourth were picked by the computer for the championship game. It was Oklahoma and LSU. You know who was the head coach at LSU at the time?
Yeah, Tommy Tuberville.
No, not Alabama.
Oh,
the guy who.
No, at LSU.
At LSU, you had the guy, Nick.
Saban. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, right. That's right. I'm sorry. Yeah, Nick Saban was. Yeah, that was the year. Yeah, that was the year.
At that time,
Tommy Tuberville actually won it.
Yeah.
And Saban.
Yeah. And part of Saban's contract was, if I take LSU to a national championship, I get a dollar more than whoever's the highest paid coach in college football, which at the time was Bob Stoops.
Right.
So by beating Bob, he got Bob's salary.
Right. That's right. Yeah, I remember that. And then he went over. Yeah.
Oh, and I have to say, that year, I'm up to Minnesota to see family for Christmas. And the Minneapolis Tribune has got this article about the real national champions are the St. John's Johnnies from Division III in St. Cloud, Minnesota, because they win the national championships without a single scholarship player. That's a real national championship. And
that's funny. Yeah. Oh, by the way, getting back to that, Tuberville was at Auburn. He was at Auburn.
Yeah.
So that's
But, you know, that's Oklahoma benefited from letting the computer do it.
Right.
Because the number one and two teams got left out. You know?
Yeah, but in the end, it still worked out. It was, the computer still ended up right.
Yeah.
So
again, a computer, the big difference is they wait all the games, whether it's September or November, they wait them the same.
Right. But they also, it's strength of schedule. I mean, the computer, right. They put all of the stuff in. And the problem, see, the problem with the sports writers is, mm-hmm. no matter how much you try to not do it, you have biases.
Oh, yeah. And it's based on incest in that when you only play your little circle, how are you supposed to prove that you're better and more deserving up in, you know, say, Oregon State than Clemson?
Right.
Because, you know, and that's why there's been a big push for this interconferencing. Like right now it's going on between the Big East and the Big 12 in basketball.
Right.
You know, those kinds of things are very helpful.
Yeah.
Because yeah. it kind of does a check. Are the computers right?
Right. We're going to see, you know, that's what one thing I like about some of the bowl games. They're, like they have the Big 12, Pac-12, and you have mm-hmm. Big 12 SEC games in the bowls. Mm-hmm. And you get to see who would have, could have, should have. Last year, for example, in the bowl games, the SEC, they had a losing record.
Yeah. That's insane.
They had a losing record in
there. I think the notoriety of the SEC is largely a creation of ESPN.
It is, totally. And it's because they actually own a part of the SEC.
That's yep.
And that should not be allowed.
Yeah.
That should not be allowed. Hey, let's transition into this new discussion. Well, we got two discussions. This is very important. Really, that's why I want to get into it. Let's not forget the new NIL deal. Okay.
Right.
But let's discuss the
realignment. Yes. If you thought July and August were wild, and it was.
And right. and a 16-team conference was a lot.
Right. Now, the latest rumor is that the Big 12 commissioner was reported to be having talks with the Atlantic Coast Conference, the ACC, about maybe merging the ACC into the Big 12.
The Big 12 ACC.
Yeah, because right now, it's going to be ugly. At this time next year, Florida State will not be in the ACC as we know it. Either it will radically change, or the ACC will, there'll be probably a big lawsuit because the contract says you want to get out, you got to pay the conference like $500 million. It's nuts, you know. And keep in mind, the Florida State is not Notre Dame. They are a public state-owned university. Right. So if the university pays out that kind of money, the taxpayers will revolt because they feel like it's their money.
Ron DeSantis.
Mm-hmm.
But it's an election year, Ron.
Yeah, and Florida State's right there in Tallahassee.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
At the state capitol.
Yeah. Yep. Didn't he go to Florida State, or was he University of Florida? He was at one of the games. I think he was at Florida State. But anyway, go ahead.
So anyway, if this happens, you'll see a hastening towards something that was wild when it was predicted 5 years ago, 10 years ago.
Super conferences.
Right. When 10 years ago, you started to see the Big 12 bleed. Now, the Big 12 bled largely because Texas, University of Texas, created their own media deal and screwed over everybody else. I mean, last Christmas, I was up in Minnesota. I ran into some people leaving a Vikings game. They're from Nebraska. We got to talking Nebraska. I said, is there any chance Nebraska comes back to the Big 12? No. I said, why'd they leave? And he said, Texas. Texas screwed everybody over, and they had no remorse whatsoever about it. And Nebraska's making so much money in the Big 12 deal. I mean, in the Big 10 deal. You know, so it is, everybody's greedy. I mean, Eddie, when we were kids, gambling was seen as corruption and vice. I mean, you've heard of the Big Apple. What is that? New York. What's the moniker for Las Vegas? Sin City. right? It's seen as corruption and sin to be in gambling. Now, all of a sudden, people aren't getting kicked out for gambling unless they gamble on their own team. But now the major driver in advertising for college sports is gambling, sports gambling. And it will not fix the problem when the money that's feeding the beast is corrupt. They won't call out corruption. And I mean, that's really, if you get at the heart of the problem, that's really it.
Yeah. And now a part of it too is the new NIL deals.
Yeah.
I mean, basically NCAA is just throwing in the towel.
Well, yeah, but that's just, you cannot impose all these rules on the athletes that you're violating the very spirit of those rules.
No, I understand. I understand. But what I'm saying, one of the ramifications is the salaries to the.
Exactly.
So honestly, what is happening is we are becoming Europe.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to end up with your Division One, Division Two, like they have in soccer.
Mm-hmm.
You got your Division One, Division Two, and then the Premier League.
Mm-hmm.
But it's going to be, you know, the pros are going to be the D1, and then your universities are going to be, because you're going to have, and high schools are going to be like your D3 or whatever,
mm-hmm.
and certain levels of junior college or smaller colleges, you know, and they're going to get paid. I still don't understand how they're going to be able to do it. To me, it's just the feudalism, though,
mm-hmm.
because let's say you take a, what's his name, the quarterback for USC that was at OU.
Yeah, Caleb Williams.
You take Caleb Williams or any of these super stud quarterbacks, mm-hmm. okay, and he gets $20 million,
mm-hmm.
and he's in college.
Yeah.
And then you got, you know, your son's a left guard.
Mm-hmm.
Mine's the right tackle.
Mm-hmm.
You know, our sons are going to get $5 million.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yet our guys are the ones with the broke, you know, with the torn knees.
Blown out the knees, necks, yeah.
The neck injuries, the backs, yeah. the this, who may not even have a future. While Cato's back there, his $25 million in college mm-hmm. pales in comparison to the $50 million he'll get when he gets drafted.
Yeah.
So, to me, there is no equitable salary situation. Now, somebody will say, oh, but you're a capitalist. You're a Republican. What are you talking about? Equitable. Well, there's a difference to me in worth. You know what I'm saying? In other words, if we're on two equal or different planes, so what you're saying is that a quarterback works less than the guy up front. But I guess in a sense, it is demand. It is demand.
Supply and demand.
And who they want. The people want to see the quarterback.
But Eddie, this is why I say the WWE has more integrity, because they're at least admitting what they are. They're putting on a show.
Yeah.
And what I'm saying is, if you remember from the movie Chariots of Fire, yeah, but the way of what do you call it? Amateurism, you know, the British, you know, and they didn't even want their Olympic athletes to pay for coaches, you know. Let the university pay for them, that's okay. But the individual, you don't have a right to get your own coach, you know, and pay for your own. But this is what I'm saying. Let's take Gabriel,
Dylan Gabriel.
He's leaving OU.
Right.
Not going to play in the bowl game.
He's going to Oregon.
The risk.
Right.
Yeah. What you have now.
This is the third school.
You have free agency and no salary caps in college sports.
Right.
When you and I were college age, you couldn't fathom that reality.
No, ever. No. And, you know, he's got the Nike money. I mean, basically, he's going to Oregon with all the
Nike. Nike owns Oregon.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's
sky's the limit for him up there. And OU, you're down here. Yeah, I mean, but this is where I think I told you about back in the 90s, late 90s. Remember Tim Gill,
mm-hmm.
the basketball player at Victory?
Sure.
And him.
Yeah, you and I both knew him personally.
Yeah. going over to RU, and I said, it's a mistake, don't go, you know. And I was at the game where Oral, they set up a special section in a corner of the gym for Oral and Richard and the families.
The peacock section.
He announced, God has told me, and I went there to stand. No, he didn't.
Oh,
Billy Joe told you to go, you know, and my wife said, you better not get up. Do not get up. I mean, I thought it was just like a mistake. And later, you know, I talked to him and Tim said,
you're not calling anybody a charlatan, are you?
No, it wasn't about charlatan. No, it wasn't charlatan. Because I know Oral and them didn't say, hey, the Lord, just saying, we want you to go. And Bill Self was the coach, and Bill Self's the one who recruited him.
Yes.
And so anyway, but it was like, to make it sound good. And in those days when you went to Victory, that's the way everybody talked, you know, I mean, everybody, the whole spirituality thing, you know? And so,
we could really get into it if we want to, but we'll keep.
No, playing. Yeah. So anyway, later he said, Mr. Huff, you were right. I never should have gone. But anyway, so when after his junior year, he and this other kid, Rocky, I can't remember his last name, Rocky something. Yeah. Anyway, they decided they wanted to transfer. He was going to go to Arkansas, play for Nolan Richardson, and Rocky was going to go to Southern Illinois. And the Tulsa media just ripped them to shreds.
Yes.
I mean, Channel 6, 2-6, 8, 23, all of them. And the newspapers, it was just awful. They made it these, you know, traitors. And how could they? They got a free, you know, a free education, blah, blah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. How could they? Why would they do this? You know. And so Nolan basically told him, he said, listen, I would just go back because they are crucifying me. And
could you answer this for me?
Well, wait, let me finish the whole story. So finally they recanted and said, okay, we're going to go ahead and stay.
Yeah.
2 weeks later, Bill Self gets a $2 million deal over at TU.
But he was going to one of our plantations.
ORU got a $1 million buyout because remember they were in debt back then, Cityplex. So they got paid off to pay off their debt. Bill got a big salary increase. And TU got a great coach who ended up, he did great over there. He ends at KU now, having become a historic coach there.
Yeah.
The two kids got screwed at ORU.
Yeah.
You never heard from him again. In fact, Tim injured his ankle and ended his career, basically. I mean, as far as going on pro, because his ankle wouldn't hold up.
Yeah.
And I talked to my nephew-in-law out of Dallas. He played it. I think he still holds the record for assists at TU.
Mm.
And he played with Tim. In this league, they have this little league, and even with his injury,
what's his name?
Harrington.
Tim.
Tim Harrington. No, not Tim Harrington. What is?
Kevin. No. I've met the guy. Yeah, didn't he have a crew cut, kind of sandy blonde hair?
Yeah,
great ball.
He's mixed. He's a mixed
kid. Yeah, great ball handler.
Oh my goodness, how can I not think of?
Yeah, I remember the Harrington guy.
Yeah,
probably one of the best guards we've had.
Yeah. So anyway, he played with Tim, and he said, Tim's one of the greatest players he's ever played with. And he ended up playing overseas. He played overseas in Europe, in Russia, and in Portugal, and Poland, and Cyprus. He played in European league. But anyway, he said Tim's one of the greatest people he's ever seen. And I actually went to a game they had here. They had all these old heads playing, and Tim was just knocking down three-pointers from everywhere.
Yeah.
But anyway, but what I was getting at, so I wrote this article. Mm-hmm. And this was in the 90s now. Mm-hmm. And it was called The Student-Athlete, The Last Slave Class in America.
Yeah, there you go.
And basically in it, I said, the coaches can do whatever they want. They can get paid what they want. They can leave and they can do this, but the players are bound. And I said, the day is coming, though. Mm-hmm. The day is coming when that student athlete will have his say. Mm-hmm. And they will get paid and they will make their demands and they will own mm-hmm. their own rights. I said, I hate to see that day come. I just said, I hate
you
to
prophesied.
I said, I hate to see that day come, but when it does, you will deserve it. Mm-hmm. That's how, and they actually printed it in the Tulsa World.
That's great.
But I mean, but I could see it coming. I mean, there's no way you could not, because the way they were treating these kids.
Yeah.
And then the Northwest, I don't know if you know, Northwestern University, the football team there, I believe they started it.
From Chicago.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Wasn't it about 5 years ago? They started with a lawsuit.
The players sued to get paid.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's what kind of started the ball rolling. Mm-hmm. And ever since then, they've been chipping away, mm-hmm. in and out, boom. And with the head of that, was it head of NCAA? One of the president of the NCAA, and I was proposing this new plan where they're...
Well, yeah, the head of the NCAA is actually talking about creating a super conference for football, or super league. Where you will have to invest in your program to the tune of like $100 million. And even Iowa State wouldn't make the cut. Oklahoma State barely makes
it. Oh, so that's what he, oh, okay. Well, I thought it was just a deal where this is what they're going to pay the athletes so much in this way and that.
Well, there's a lot to it. I was simplifying. I'm just kind of giving you the bullet point that who's included. Who makes the cut to be invited? See, to this.
So basically, all you're doing is creating a new NFL.
You're creating a live golf.
Yeah, that is. It's just professionally. It's a D2 mm-hmm. instead of like in what's in a Premier League. Mm-hmm. You have the Division One in England. You have the Premier League, and then you have the Division One underneath and Division Two.
Yeah.
So that's kind of how it'll be.
Because it used to be just all colleges played each other, right. And they formed these conferences. And then somebody had the big idea of, why do we get that conference to end the year playing champion of this?
So are they going to, are they going to have a relegation?
But yeah.
At the end of the bottom three get relegated and the top three get to move up. And
Jim Thorpe, who people would argue today may still been the best football player ever, mm-hmm. played for Carmichael, a little college. Indian school in Pennsylvania. Uh-huh. And, it's to me, I'm sorry, but just take it out of colleges, because it isn't about an education anymore.
It's a racket,
and no more than military service should be considered part of your high school, your college education. Now there's a GI Bill for you after you finish, right. But it's just, I'm sorry, be honest about who you are.
Yeah.
And it's just a racket.
It is.
I wanted to ask something.
I need the root of all evil.
Without cutting off your point, no. Tim Gill, had he communicated with Nolan Richardson prior to that announcement? It's my understanding they weren't even allowed to talk to other coaches, weren't allowed to talk to players from other teams.
Oh, no, I'm sure he had. Yeah, I'm sure he had talked to him. No, I think you could talk to him because you could, when in an off season or whatever, you could, because you were able to leave a school and transfer.
It was very hard to.
Right.
The transfer portal.
No, the only thing that stopped, there wasn't a portal then.
Right.
Right. But you could transfer, but you had to sit out a year.
Yes. Right. That's it. That's the big deal. And when you've only got 4 years of playing time and stuff, it's.
But see, then again, it all matters. So, for example, when Baker Mayfield left Texas Tech mm-hmm. and he transferred to Texas. To OU. OU, yeah. I'm sorry. Excuse me. Mm-hmm. But anyway, Kingsbury made a big deal out of it, saying he should not have been allowed to transfer, because the rule was you can't transfer in the conference.
Unless the team you leave, they give an exception.
Right.
They grant
it. Right. They grant. Right. Right. And so, and they didn't, he didn't want him in the conference. He was, so you could transfer anywhere, but you can't transfer in conference. Mm-hmm. But then they ruled, no, that doesn't count. They just went on and let him do it. Now, see, had it been probably at Texas going to OU or OU to Texas,
yeah,
they'd probably say no.
Yeah.
See, so that's why certain schools had certain
yeah
privileges in those days. But once they did that,
yeah,
it ended. Because if you think about it, after that, you know, you got Kyler Murray, you got what's his name? The guy, the Eagles came from Alabama. You know, I mean, you just started.
Yo, Jalen.
Yeah, every Jalen. Year, you know, Dylan Gabriel. I mean, mm-hmm. it's every year OU has a new quarterback and he's not been recruited out of high school. It's a transfer quarterback every year.
Yeah.
And so it's one of these deals where even OSU, you know, the quarterback they have this year, what's his name? He started at Texas Tech. And he was great his freshman year, and then he almost died. He had a very serious injury. He came back the next year, got injured again. Then he ended up going up to Michigan for a year and then came back to OSU.
Yeah, I mean, they're just moving around from team to team to team. Yeah. Brent Yormark is the commissioner of Big 12. And he's probably the gutsiest.
Yeah, I know.
Considered the most brilliant guy.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the Pac-12 was resting on their laurels. They thought they were bigger than they were. There's only so much demand for TV, you know, games to watch. And by Pac-12 kind of holding out, they basically green-lighted, come get our contract and steal it from us. And Brent Yormark, thank you very much. I'll do that.
Yeah, he did.
And he got it. And now there was no money left to spend on football because there's just only so much, you know, people want. But what I fear is going to happen, Eddie, when you start getting these 20 to 24 team super conferences, I just say you got to remember what happened to the WAC, you know, the Western Athletic Conference. They grew to 16 teams, and then some of the oldest teams that were the heart and soul in the middle got divided, split in half, rivalries cut, and all that. You got to avoid the disaster that happened in the WAC.
Well, see, that's what I fear with OU.
Mm-hmm.
See, OU now, they're not playing OSU.
Right.
And they're not playing, you know, the old Southwest of the old Big 12.
I don't think they want to play Kansas State anymore.
Well, and Iowa State, those two in particular have been a bane to them. But so, you know, so are they going to enjoy playing Arkansas every year? You know, LSU, are those going to be the big new rivalries? You know, who's Texas going to play? You know, Texas isn't going to have Baylor. Tech.
Well, the TCU. Aggie game will be fun.
The Aggie game will be fun. But Aggie, they're horrible. They've been horrible every year. I don't know. It's so funny to me because A&M every year has a top 10 recruiting class.
Yeah.
They're always, Texas A&M top 10 recruiting class. They brought in, what's his name from Florida State, the coach. Oh, yes, they're on the road. You know, they get this number 4, number 5 recruiting class. They're still bad, you know, and you wonder what in the heck is going on there? Why can they not win they don't even show up in the top 2 or 3, you know? And so it's just one of these things that they just can't get over that hump.
Yeah. No, the A&M had one good run is when they come across a guy named Johnny Manziel, and then they put a broken arrow kid to be his coach. Jake Spavital was the quarterback coach for him. They had a good run there.
You know where he is?
I think he's back at Cal.
Yeah, he's at Cal.
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw him.
Yeah, he's from quite a pedigree. You know?
He was the quarterback when my son played. My son was running back.
Yeah, and then
senior year.
And I think Zach, his brother, was a running back.
No, he was a defensive back.
Okay, I know he was a punt returner too. Yeah. You know, and of course their dad was a coach. Kind of ended his career at Broken Arrow. Mm-hmm. But their father, grandfather, was a professional football player.
Oh, I didn't know.
Yeah. Anyway, I don't know what's going to happen, but I think what you're going to see and what I proposed last fall in the Big 12 is when you get to 16 teams, then you have four quadrants in football where you play the other three teams in your conference, and then you play half of the others 1 year. The next year, you play the other half. But in your little district, you play them every year. Those are your rivalries.
Right. So Texas Tech would play, say, TCU, SMU, since they're in the ACC now, if that comes.
Yeah.
And probably Baylor, let's say.
Well, I'll just do it from the map I drew on the Big 12 under the new format, which there are going to be 16 teams coming up, is everybody west of Gallup, New Mexico was the West. And that was Arizona State.
Oh, I forgot about them.
Yeah, Utah and BYU.
Okay.
And then everybody east of Fort Smith, you know, and that's going to be Central Florida, Cincinnati, West Virginia, and Iowa State. Then everybody north of I-40 that's in that middle section is north, and everybody south, the Texas teams, will be, you know, but you'll play them every year.
Right.
But
and then you also add four teams from the other.
Yeah, half of the rest. So that's a total of nine games. And then you get to play your own early, you know, freelance kind of stuff, non-conference. Yeah. But if you do something like that, now I was suggesting with 16 teams, you still just have your championship game best conference records. Mm-hmm. However, the recommendation, if you go to 24 teams, and I'm getting a lot of this from Big 12 Sports podcast, is they're saying if you do four divisions, six in each one, you just play your division and your non-conference, and then you stop the season a week early, and then you have a semifinals and a finals. You win your district, you go to the conference tournament. It's four teams, 2 weeks, and you still have your conference championship and head-to-head, and it's not going to be based on some computer algorithm. It's win-loss. You know, so that may be where we're going. And it's not just us, because, I mean, isn't the Big Ten going to be like 20 teams?
It's a lot of teams, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they've got Washington, Oregon, USC, and Cal on top of already there, where they have six. They already had, 14, I think? I think they're 18. I think they're to 18 now.
Yeah. So you just can't be playing everybody. Yeah. And you already have grumbling. Like, remember the whole tiebreaker that Oklahoma State won, because they happen to play the other two teams in the tiebreaker scenario, whereas OU didn't have Kansas State on their schedule.
Right.
You know, then they're wishing they did. But really, since Oklahoma State beat both of them, it doesn't matter.
Right.
You know, right. I mean, look, it just, OU, this is the problem. There are teams that get all hyped up all year just for the week they're going to play you. Yeah. And when you're OU, these are the problems that are good problems. You are such a big target. It's a compliment, but you got to be on your A game every week.
Yeah.
To say that.
Yeah. No, it's going to be interesting, but yeah, that would be really interesting if that comes to pass, ACC and the Big 12. And honestly, I hope they do it. I wish they would do it. And because somebody needs to teach ESPN and them. It'd be good if Fox and, say, CBS or NBC, which has the smallest right now, NBC probably has the most money and the least exposure in college football.
Right.
No. So NBC really would be do themselves well if they would, because they don't have any Saturday. They do Notre Dame.
Yeah.
That's all they do.
Is that okay? I was going to ask that because that was the first
right
thing. As soon as the ruling came down, was the Supreme Court ruling that the NCAA couldn't control this? And Notre Dame struck first, made a deal with NBC. Nobody saw it coming.
Right. But if NBC said, okay, from now on, we're going to have two games, three games every Saturday, mm-hmm. like everybody else, mm-hmm. then boy, that then that opens a whole new pot. Mm-hmm. But they, if they negotiate a deal with the new big ACC, you know, mm-hmm. we call it, instead of the Big 12, just call it the Big ACC or the Big 12 ACC or whatever you want to call it, you know.
Or the Big 24.
Yeah, the Big 24. Yeah, there you go. Big 12 times two or whatever.
Yeah, but, I think you get rid of numbering.
Yeah, no, you're right. Yeah. The Big CC.
Yes.
There you go. That's actually pretty cool, the Big CC. But anyway, you know, imagine if they were the first ones to jump out there and say, we want to be your network. Mm-hmm. And then NBC, you know, after, because they have NBC, they have Paramount, remember? They have Paramount, and they have a couple of others. Oh, CNBC, MSNBC. I mean, they could fill the airwave with stations to put games on. They don't need ESPN because yep. they've got all these other stations. They could have games on like five different NBC affiliates.
Oh, and everybody's going to TVs, smart TVs, where you can just pull up like Roku, you know, or anything.
Right, but I'm just saying, yeah, but see, the different networks only have so many outlets. Like CBS, for example, Paramount is CBS, right? So NBC, what is NBC's, I don't want to waste time, but NBC has several
that are cable channels.
Cable channels, exactly.
Right. And what I'm saying is
to compete with ESPN.
Right. And I'm just saying going to streaming.
Or streaming, right.
Where you don't need the cable networks.
Right.
It, to me, because one of my favorite Roku apps was called Pluto.
Pluto, yeah.
And I remember when it was just one guy. Started it himself. He did all his own ads and everything. And he had a cat channel where his cute little kitties, you know, all kinds of stuff. And it was just whatever was available on the web free. That's, you know, Creative Commons. And you know who bought him out? Viacom.
Really?
Yes. Then it's CBS. They saw the value in that mm-hmm. because it's its own dish network. And I was just watching it last night because, I mean, listen, when you got a wife who likes Christmas movies, they got multiple Christmas
movies. Oh, man,
movies.
They have such D and E and F movies, you know, not the A-rated B.
Oh, I mean, they got Hallmark stuff.
Oh, my God. But they got some of the weirdest and craziest monster movies.
In three fireplace channels. They just have a crackling fire.
Really? Three of them. One's not enough.
Christmas music, and one is just the natural sounds of the fireplace. Yeah.
We better move on.
Yeah. So anyway, college sports.
Is good. Stay tuned. Yeah.
This was a wild year. The new year, 24. Yeah.
Well, I hope it works out. I would love, man, if the ACC and Big 12 got together. That would just be such a blow to Clemson and Florida State jump to the Big 12.
North Carolina is a lot.
Well, yeah, North Carolina. But see, there's a couple of them. There's even more in North Carolina State because they're always a good basketball
team. They are. You imagine an already powerful Big 12 basketball and you add
the Syracuse. I mean, you know, you've got so many basketball in the ACC. Mm-hmm. I mean, ACC could just rule in just basketball and then add the football, and the football programs would probably jump up. Wow.
Yeah.
Got me excited, everyone. Hey, Dave, I want to jump to in the world of politics, for those of you that are worn out,
we sometimes on our cover sports. Politics.
Yeah, we sometimes. Yeah, usually it's the other way around. A lot of politics, a little bit of sports. Yeah. But George Santos.
Oh, bye bye.
We haven't covered here. Republicans are some of the stupidest people in the world. I have to say, mm-hmm. they don't know how to play the game.
Yes.
It goes back to my story I told you about mm-hmm. Fair One. You remember? Mm-hmm. How you fight a street fight. Mm-hmm. an inner city street fight. Mm-hmm. Democrats know how to play it well. Republicans don't know how to play it. Mm-hmm. And I was glad to see, apparently in Oklahoma, Josh Brahim, congressman from the second district, mm-hmm. down Muskogee and mm-hmm. that all the way up.
Indian country.
Indian country, yeah. Right. He voted no mm-hmm. to get rid of sanctions. He, to my surprise,
it was Kevin Hearn.
Kevin Hearn, but no, he didn't surprise me. I was glad to see, but
the other three voted yes.
No, I think, what's his name, didn't.
Lucas, Cole, Vice, those are the three. The other three.
Isn't there one more, Congressman?
There's only five now.
Oh, what happened to, what was his name? There used to be another one. I guess that is it.
Yeah.
Okay. Vice take the place of?
Well, Reynolds, was it, Joe? I think, what was his name?
Okay.
But anyway, yeah.
Yeah, but anyway, yeah, okay. But yeah, good. So Josh and Kevin Hearn,
yep.
they voted to retain him.
Yeah.
And they should. You know, to me, no official charge was ever levied against him.
Right.
And so it was never proven in a court of law.
No due process here.
No due process. Mm-hmm. And if it was such an offense, it should have been up to the voters of his district to get rid of him, not up to his colleagues, and especially those who hated him. But yet over 100 members of the House of Representatives voted him out. And the Republicans, for some reason, seem to have felt that it was noble of them to have voted him out. No, it was not noble. It was stupid and dumb. I think we are down to a majority of two, aren't we?
Yeah. And yeah, because there's another vacancy. It's like our majority isn't slim enough. We got to pare it down a little bit.
You know, it's something that Rush Limbaugh once said, that Republicans don't really want to lead. They seem to like to be the minority party. And they seem to like just being the antagonists. Mm-hmm. They would rather the Democrats have the majority and they run on, we're going to change things, or we don't like this, or being the fly in the ointment,
yeah.
rather than taking the responsibility of leadership.
Yep.
And it's sad. That's sad. If you can't handle the heat, then yes, you need to get out of the kitchen, but you should never run. Mm-hmm. And I'm afraid it's the same thing in Oklahoma City. You've got a bunch of people that want to get $30,000 a year salary and work a few months, and that's it. That's all you want to do. You don't really want to lead. You don't really want to do the right thing for your state, your district, your country. And I'm so sick of it. It's just ridiculous. Yeah.
You know, I want to say some of the statements I've read for people who voted no, it wasn't that any of them approved of the conduct, whether legally or morally, of what's his name?
Santos.
Yes. Yeah, because I was reading about Loretta Sanchez, one of the famous conservatives in the Congress back in the 80s and 90s, B1 Bob Dornan. Yeah, he was a firebrand, but there was severe corruption in Southern California, and Loretta Sanchez defeated him in Orange County, which was overwhelmingly conservative back then. And
she's a Democrat, by the way,
right?
Loretta Sanchez.
And Newt Gingrich would not remove Sanchez, or would not even fight. It was Bob Dornan says, you can't swear her in, because there's so much corruption here, you've got to hold off until you've investigated this. And Newt just looked the other way. And Bob Dornan lost his seat. And That's why when they were both running 2012, they ran into each other at CPAC, and Bob Dornan just ripped into Newt face to face, criticizing his beer belly. It was the funniest thing to watch, you know. And anyway, so what I'm saying is, look, when we start investigating the lies and the corruption of Democrats and holding them accountable, then yeah, we will hold Santos to the same standard.
Well, we did have we had a clear evidence of a Democrat breaking the law, removing signs and pulling a fire alarm.
Multiple
fire alarms.
Yeah.
Signs and pulling a fire alarm. And which is a crime. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's an actual crime.
Yeah.
And yet, what do we do?
Yeah.
And he's still there. And then lying, perjuring himself.
And the motivation was to undermine the work of the Congress, right, which is what they're throwing.
January 6th.
You're undermining, interrupting a congressional action.
Right.
You know? So this, clearly whatever the worst case of a January 6th sentence is what he should have got.
Yet he gets nothing.
No,
he gets nothing
because he's a Democrat. Yeah. And we don't want to fight.
No. Really? And so what do Republicans, they think that they are noble somehow. We're better than them. No, you're not. Nobody cares. Nobody cares that that you're better. The Democrats are happy, laughing behind your backs. And they're going to work now to get that seat, these seats that are now vacated, to get them back, win those seats and take the majority.
Well, I will tell you, and there is a school of thought, political science. When you're the minority in the electoral base, a special session is easier for you to win than a general election. We've seen that in Oklahoma here, where we've had special sessions because a legislator who might be in his fourth or fifth term and he's looking for his golden hammock, and all of a sudden, let's say the Norman Chamber of Commerce wants to offer him a cushy job, and he leaves the house, and then they have to call for a special election for that district. And over again, the Democrats have picked up those special elections because their numbers are smaller, but they're more motivated. I'm sorry, the Republican voters are apathetic in this state.
Well, yeah, and probably nationally. You saw what happened in the last election.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is when you go to New York City and Santos district is Queens and Brooklyn, and the Republicans there are more motivated than the Democrats. The opposite is true of what we see here in Oklahoma, where Democrats are activist minority group. And so the thinking is we may be able to pluck that seat in a special election easier than in the general election.
Well, we'll see.
Yeah.
Well, we will see.
Yeah, it's theory. That's all it is theory.
Exactly. It's better. Yeah. I go by the bird in the hand theory.
Yes. You've got the seat and you want, and why? I mean, you saw the State of the Union where Mitt Romney's chewing him out. And I'm like, oh, this is funny. And he's just giving it back to Romney.
Well, I saw the bad lip syncing version. Exactly. Bad lip reading, yeah.
But, they base that on some kind of discourse. It did not look friendly.
Yeah, no, it wasn't, yeah.
Right? And this is Mr. Sanhedrin Romney. Look, he's a Mormon bishop, and he thinks he's more holy than. Because he's calling out sin, and I'm sorry, but you're the bigger liar, Mitt, and Mitt has stabbed more people in the back politically.
Oh, yeah.
And then for him to say, oh, you are immoral, man. I'm sorry. I just don't see it there.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know what the deal is with Mitt Romney, what happened to him where, he should have stopped. His claim to fame was the Salt Lake City Olympics.
Yeah.
And you
should. Where he lied to our federal government to get all kinds of government funding.
Really?
Oh, yeah. And he bragged about it. Afterwards, he just claimed, well, it's for this. It's for this.
Well, he bamboozled me because I was a supporter back then. I even have a picture when he came here, me and him. I'm just, smiling with him and everything. And I want to throw darts at that picture now, you know.
You're not the only one. I've talked to a lot of people, you know, it was
2012, wasn't it?
2012 was the second run. His first run, there was him, Huckabee, and McCain.
Okay, it must have been the first run. What is it, that far back? Man, time flies.
That was in 08.
Okay, that was
okay. And yeah, a lot of people, you know, believe the rhetoric because they didn't have much to base it on, you know. And then in 12... some of us had picked up on it. I was a Santorum. Actually, I ran the Santorum, Oklahoma campaign with a lot of help from great people out there. But a lot of my friends, a very wealthy Republican who I've worked campaigns with, he was all Romney guy. The other day I was at his house and he says, man, you bring up Romney. He says, what a disappointment. And this is one of his top funders and fundraisers.
Yeah.
Says to me that, you know, and... yeah. You know, and you try to be gracious when you want to say, I told you.
Hey, moving on. Trump, he now leads. His lead has increased. Every time these guys have a debate, his lead increases. Mm-hmm. I just saw where he's like 60% was his latest in one of the latest polls. 60% of Republican voters now support him. And here's a really crazy thing. DeSantis is down to 13%. Haley was at 16%.
Yeah.
So it's not getting any better. The greatest thing he's ever done, greatest decision that Donald has made, I believe, is not getting involved in these debates.
Yes.
You know, it's funny. It's kind of, he's pulling the almost the Biden strategy, right?
Yeah.
Remember Biden with
the basement strategy.
Yeah, the basement strategy.
Yeah.
But he his is a little different. He's doing his own rallies with it's just him, and then he can sit there and talk about their debates.
Yeah.
And then of course you got Christie out there who is just making a fool of himself.
Yeah. And now there are, you know, we have to be honest here. When we see a poll we really like, we like to amplify one. We try to pretend we didn't see the other ones. Babylon Bee had a headline about a polling, and I'll pull that up here when you get a chance.
Okay, you want me to keep talking while you search?
Ahead. Yeah, because I want to get it right. I want to get it right.
Yeah. So, but yeah, they had a debate the other evening that hardly anyone watched.
Here it is.
Yeah.
Ron DeSantis turns in a killer performance, slashing Trump's lead to only 39 points.
Slashing it only 39 points. Yeah, it's kind of sad, really, mm-hmm. in a way. And they just keep going, you know. And why? Have you seen this AI recording? Did we talk about that before? There's an AI recording of DeSantis.
Oh, yeah.
Conceding,
yeah.
It's amazing. I mean, it looks so authentic and genuine. And he says all the right things. I mean, he says exactly what he should be saying, but it's not him.
Yeah.
And I don't, you know, that shows how good and how scary it can be to have the AI generated video because it's a speech of Ron DeSantis essentially conceding to Trump.
Yeah.
And my wife finally showed it to me and I said, wow.
Oh, a little bit of media news that really surprised me. Well, first of all, the journalists at the Washington Post are planning a strike. They're actually kind of doing a rolling strike.
At the Washington Post?
Washington Post, which is owned by Bezos, of his Amazon company. But of all the people to stand by them in solidarity, the Babylon Bee. Here's the headline. Babylon Bee writers stand in solidarity with our fellow fake news writers going on strike at the Washington Post.
That's good. That's a good one.
Coffee is just on a roll this week.
Yeah, well, they usually are. They're really good. I mean, it's incredible the stuff they come up with, you know.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, man, that is good.
Yeah.
Yeah. That is funny. But, yeah, back to the whole deal. I encourage all of you out there, if you're not on X, okay, please get on there.
Absolutely.
And I'll tell you why, because although all of these leftists swore that they would get off with Elon Musk, I'm noticing they haven't left. And yeah, they're really mounting an amazing battery of attacks. And the ones that I'm seeing the most are the Lincoln Project, mm-hmm, and there's several of these anti-Trump pseudo Republican, pseudo conservative organizations that are attacking him, and they're just on there all the time. And it behooves us true conservatives and Trump supporters to get in and knock it down. Just put facts on there, attack back, put facts, put stories about Biden up there and things like that, because we got to counter. We've got to counter.
Barbara Streisand says, if Trump wins, this time she really means it. She's going to move to Canada. Hey, I want to say something. This is a little unscripted. Those who follow national politics and kind of wonks know that Americans for Prosperity, AFP, which is kind of a Koch brothers thing, which now there's only one of the two Koch brothers, is one of those groups that really does not want Trump. Really doesn't.
They never have. In fact, I've been against them for probably the last 15 years.
Yeah.
I saw where they were really at about 15 years ago.
Yeah. I'm going to talk to a small crowd, a small select bunch of you, but you probably know who you are. And that is people who really get active to make a difference on policy in Oklahoma. One of the people on the team that's really making a difference is actually AFP Oklahoma, Americans for Prosperity, the Oklahoma organization, headed up by John Tidwell. John's a great guy, Oklahoman. He and I butted heads back when I was working for Bridenstine's election, upsetting his guy, because he used to work for John Sullivan. And so we had a very rocky beginning of our interactions. And now I think we both found the value in each other working together as a team. And I'm just going to urge you folks, what's going on with AFP on a national level, do not let it distract you from the important work that AFP in Oklahoma is doing, headed up by, you know, a great Oklahoman, John Tidwell. And I just, John and I haven't talked about this. I just sense they could use a message like this, encouraging people. The work we have to do in Oklahoma is too important to let something outside of Oklahoma distract it.
Well, my only question would be, how much of funding from Oklahoma would go to the national?
I would speculate. Now, I can't say this authoritatively. I would speculate zero. I would speculate the national funding for AFP subsidizes Oklahoma. Mm. I have not seen, and Tidwell and I have worked on things for pretty much a decade. And he works hand in hand with OCPA, Jonathan Small, a lot. So if you don't have a problem with OCPA, you shouldn't have a problem with what John Tidwell's okay. doing in
right.
Oklahoma.
So AFP Oklahoma is not campaigning or doing any anti-Trump type of thing.
I have not seen anything. And I mean, Tidwell is a wise, disciplined guy when it comes to keeping his mouth shut. And his whole team is well-disciplined. They're a well-oiled machine, a very small group.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and they've worked hand-in-hand with, well, in fact, one of the AFP guys left to become a district office director for Kevin Hearn. And so there's great collaboration. It's a good team. We're working together. And part of the magic of it is that we don't allow things to distract us that shouldn't. You've got to, especially when you're dealing with policy and legislation, just because you're upset about one guy's vote one week doesn't mean you burn bridges where you can't work together the next week. So anyway, I wasn't planning to say that, but I just really feel moved that we've got to drive home that message.
Yeah, that is true. You can't be in disagreement on everything. I just think for years, Americans for Prosperity have seemed to be on the wrong side of things.
Nationally, yeah.
Nationally, right. Mm-hmm. And I just, I really don't get it, other than the Koch brothers' interests don't totally line up with many of the interests of the rest of us. Let's just put it that way, because of their business. They're importing gas, oil, well, petroleum, raw petroleum, and then refining it here.
Yeah.
Things like that. It's just...
I do want to explain, of the two brothers, and I don't want to say the names because I get them wrong. I forget. But one of them, who passed away a couple of years ago, was very libertarian oriented. And the other was kind of more moderate chamber of commerce type guy, you know. And so without that libertarian influence, some of the things that maybe weren't as big a priority now are. For instance, you know, the more open borders kind of stance is now a more prominent thing. Seeing Trump's build the wall just, you know, infuriated that. And there's a lot of chamber of commerce type interests that want the cheap labor.
Yeah, sure, exactly.
They want to drive down prices. And then they, at the same time, the Democrats are marching, we got to have a living wage, we got to have a living wage. And yet, you idiots don't realize that your open border policy is what's hurting your living wage.
That's what I don't understand, how they're so short-sighted that they can't understand that it's, you know, so, you know, the whole big thing that was what in the 80s, nice sustainability.
Yeah.
If anything is unsustainable,
yeah,
it is the sustainability of importing these different cultures,
yeah,
from all over the world and expecting them to thrive. The,
right.
The reason that they were able to survive early on is because it was limited numbers and they were small enough to assimilate and be assimilated by the broader populace.
Yeah, and but, kept it diverse deliberately so right. No one faction rose to be that big.
Exactly. And now all of a sudden, I'll tell you what, when it's going to hit the fan is when you get the Hispanics and the Black people together.
Mm-hmm.
They don't like each other. Mm-hmm. It's like oil and water. They just don't like each
other.
And
they both hate the Asians.
or are hated by the Asians because the Asians think they're better than them and they think that it's just crazy. So at some point, it's just not going to work.
Yeah. I'm just thinking, remember when Cesar Chavez and the agriculture workers,
yeah,
he was the most anti-open borders there was because he knew that that was what's destroying his work to bring up the standard of living of these migrant workers.
Yeah. Yeah, that's all they're doing. They're bringing in the flooding it to keep the wages down.
Exactly.
And they don't even see that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the ones that are here. Well, I think some of them are along the border. In fact, that's what's driving the Hispanic vote to the GOP.
Yeah.
The Black vote is going to the GOP.
Yeah.
Because they're slowly starting to see in Chicago, in New York, in Los Angeles, in these places, they're starting to finally see what's going on. Wait a minute. These people are taking our money. They're taking our housing. They're taking our this, our that, all of our benefits.
Yeah.
You know, when I go down to the welfare office, I can't get in because there's a 2 mile long line
mm-hmm.
of these foreigners.
Yeah.
And so eventually that's, you know, people are going to say, yeah, you know, and they can try to blame the Republicans on this. And nope, you did yeah. that. You know?
Yeah, I had a neighbor as a kid back in the 70s in high school. I kind of got to know him a little better. He hated the Minnesota winters. Hated. Mm-hmm. Had a house just down at the corner from ours. But he spent more and more time in Texas. And he was an appliance repairman, had his own business. And he finally moved back here for good. I said, so, you know, why didn't Texas work out for you? He says, all the open borders and immigration. He says, you can't make a good living when you got that kind of, you know, just they're pouring in.
Yeah, I don't understand how these mayors are getting reelected and governors in New Mexico, for example, mm-hmm. in particular. It's just crazy. I don't know how that's happening.
Yeah.
You know, Arizona, New Mexico, mm-hmm. and mayors in Texas, like in El Paso, how that mayor is getting reelected. And yeah. She may not the next time. We'll see what happens.
But yeah.
It's crazy. Hey, by the way, so anyway, to recap, Trump's lead seems to be growing. The others are sitting there arguing with each other. They try to attack Trump, but they can't seem to make anything stick because mm-hmm. his base is solid. Mm-hmm. I mean, and the more they talk, the more they make fools of themselves.
Yep.
And so there's really nothing they can
do. And you're letting them devour each other.
Yeah.
And the best thing going is that Vivek Ramaswamy is in there. Without collaborating with Trump, he is very much on the same ideological track.
Yep.
And they cannot debate the man.
No. And although the media, the left-wing media, and even some of the Fox, for example, mm-hmm. moderate, if you want to call them right, semi-left, mm-hmm. They're starting to attack Vivek.
Well, they're triggered by him.
Yeah, yeah.
They can't stand what he's saying. Right. And the audience applauds him.
Yeah, yeah. That's
and, the thing. And I'm like, yeah, you go.
Yeah, yeah. No, he's another unfettered, unfiltered. He's just going to tell you how it is. And I didn't realize that he's basically a billionaire. I think mm-hmm. his net worth is 900 and some million dollars. Yeah. Might as well be a billionaire, mm-hmm. you know, who's counting pennies.
Yeah, that's a brilliant thing when somebody, you can't own him.
No.
You know, right. That is a dangerous man.
And you can't say that his wife is a surgeon, mm-hmm. you know, and it's not just any kind of surgeon. She's some like special mm-hmm. high-end doctor, mm-hmm. you know, he has a degree from MIT and Harvard.
Wow.
I mean, you know.
Well, the MIT is kind of impressive. Harvard doesn't impress me anymore.
Yeah, right.
It doesn't.
Yeah, no, I understand. But MIT's getting there as well.
Yeah, they are.
But just in general, you know, and he's a Hindu that went to Catholic school.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the guy is so full of different, you know, contradictions. Is just kind of funny. You know?
Yeah, I consider him a Socratic believer. Socrates is very much believed. There's probably just one guy.
Well, yeah, I didn't realize because I looked him up and read, and the strain of Hinduism that he comes from is a monotheistic Hinduism. One God. He believes in one God, mm-hmm. and they believe in angels.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what they call gods are like angels.
Mm-hmm.
They're not. You know, there's the supreme being, and then there's these sub being.
Yeah, and I have to say, as a Christian, and you and I have both gone to Bible school and, you know, study, and not just new to the faith, what we know about angels is kind of sketchy, actually very sketchy, because the Greek language is not sufficient. The Greek language is messenger, which has been translated demons, angels, and apostles. That same Greek word.
Yeah.
You know, they know love better than us because they got four separate words for what we call love. But on
angels,
angelic what? Beings and stuff and spirit beings.
Boy, even the description of them is mm-hmm. so unusual. You know, because when they went to Ezekiel, mm-hmm. Ezekiel's wheel, mm-hmm. the different descriptions in Ezekiel. And then when they appeared, you know, to Abraham mm-hmm. in the Old Testament and to Ishmael and his mother, or actually to Hagar. And when they appeared later, you know, to Mary and the different times they appeared. it's just kind of, you know, they're all different.
Yeah, so. You know what I take from it? It's not that important. If it was that important, God would have taught. The Bible is the history of man, not the history of God, not the history of angels, the history of man. And that's what we got to focus on. It's our user's manual. You know, God tells us, here's how I want you to live.
Yeah. And if God wants you to know, he'll let one appear to you.
There you go. That's what I believe.
The Justice Department, Justice Department, the Injustice Department, more.
Okay. Yeah. Anyway, you're on it.
they have just yesterday, I guess, filed charges against Hunter now.
You don't say.
Yeah, but nothing is ever as it seems, is it? It's just crazy. So now what the suspicion is, I don't know. I kind of buy it, but I don't know. But the suspicion for you all out there in Jinx and other places is that the reason that they filed the charges now is so that he can be pardoned before Joe leaves office.
Yeah.
That's what they, so basically they want him convicted and then to have it timed with Joe Biden leaving office and pardoning him. Mm-hmm. The problem is, who's going to pardon Joe Biden?
Mm. Ooh. Yeah.
And what I think, if the Congress is smart, they will time their charges to come after the election,
mm-hmm.
so that he can't get away.
Yeah.
So he can't be pardoned. So either if Joe wins, he can cover for him or pardon him again, or if he doesn't, then they can charge him and have him convicted after the election.
Yeah. Babylon Bee has a very short headline. It says, Hunter Biden indicted for not paying taxes on his bribes. Because that's the point.
That's basically.
There's no. Yeah. It's like, yeah, we know you took the money from him. We know you split it with your dad, you know, but you didn't pay your taxes first.
Yeah.
And we're only getting you on taxes.
Yeah.
I have to say, though, the federal tax court is the hardest to fight against as a defendant.
Unless you're a Biden.
Yes, that's true. Yeah. It's kind of like the day we were talking to Bill Shepard. He says, do you know anybody who lives there, like, you know, making money off the government? And I said, well, yeah, one, Hunter Biden. Yeah. Bill couldn't argue with that, you know. But, you know, this is the thing. He's, you know, you got to dig into it. It's one of those, another one of those, nothing to see here, move along.
Right, right. Oh, exactly. Exactly. You know, I think your camera, did it quit or?
Oh, gosh. Well, we may have lost our battery. Anyway, that's the Facebook Live one. Yeah.
We're going to have to work on that.
Yeah. I'm going to have to use a different
camera.
Yeah, camera thing.
Yeah.
But in a couple of weeks here, I think we should have all the bugs worked up and we'll be going straight to laptop and go live. So
that'll be good. That'll
be good. I do have one more headline.
Okay. I've got a couple. Go ahead with your headline.
Well, yes. If you aren't aware, the Oklahoma public schools grades, and I mean, this is the State Department of Education grading the schools on their student body. And I am shocked. And you know what's funny to me? The media is largely ignoring this.
Of course.
Now, you and I live in Tulsa County, right? Happen to both live in the city of Tulsa. We always like to say, yeah, those urban schools are such a failure. Do you know, in the top 90 high schools in the state, not a one of them is Tulsa County. It's not until you get to 93 is Jinx, 94 is Bixby. And about half or less of their students are competent at grade level in high school in math and reading. Math and reading. Half. And that puts you in the top 100 out of, let's say, about what? 500 high schools in the state. You know, this is pathetic. And it's not just TPS. all of them. Eddie, I mean, obviously you always had, you know, kids with learning disabilities, and you and I are growing up, you had kids with special needs, kids who just were never going to get there because, you know, until God gives them their miracle. And it's not just they didn't buckle down or take enough Ritalin. You know, there's always going to be some. But half your student body is in remedial, or should be. That's a problem.
You know what's going to happen, though?
What?
They're going to blame it on our new
superintendent. Oh, yeah. It's always somebody else's fault.
Right, right.
Yeah. And here's the other.
It won't be the 8 years under, because yeah. I remember back, what was it, about 8 years ago, mm-hmm. after Parisi or under Parisi, mm-hmm. when Bixby was at the top and Jenks was right behind it and Owosso was up there. Mm-hmm. At least those schools were up there.
Yeah.
Tulsa City schools weren't doing yeah. that well, but at least those were.
Yeah.
And what about Booker T? Where was it?
Actually, Booker T was the top, or in the top 100. They were really close behind Jinx.
Oh, so they were behind Jinx, though?
Yes.
Wow, that's interesting.
Well, yeah. Keep in mind, if you go to Booker T, it's for one of two reasons. You live in yep, that
right.
section mm-hmm. of the district, which is largely impoverished.
Right.
Or you were smart enough to get chosen to come in
right.
to make their average numbers look good.
Right.
They call it a magnet school. It's really cover up our worst failure school. Right. That's really what it is. Mm-hmm. In fact, there was a time when McLean should have, by law, had to be shut down for failure. And Nancy Garrett? I forget her first name.
Sandy Garrett.
Sandy Garrett, yeah. Sandy's bright idea was, let's just merge Booker T in with McLean. In other words, we're not fixing the problem. We're just going to stir the pot so you can't see the failures as clearly.
Wow. What about Oklahoma City? How did they come out?
A little worse.
Worse?
Yeah. I mean.
Oh, man.
So, yeah, the top 100 schools were almost completely very rural. Very rural.
Are they going to try to blame this on a year of Ryan Walters?
No, no. This was last year's numbers.
Oh, this was from the year before.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. I mean, Joy Hoffmeister is the worst failure we've ever had.
Oh, I believe it. I believe it. We knew that.
She was the one that said that, you know, bottom 10% is not good enough. She dropped us worse. Now, this is.
She put us at the top of the negative
yeah.
number. Yeah.
Oh, it's horrible. It's the look the other way. Here's. Yeah. She did. She empowered, you know, the radicals, the teachers union leadership.
Where CRT became more prominent than
yeah.
actual the three R's.
She tried to do it very quietly.
Yeah.
And when the teacher strike, the wildcat strike, the illegal teacher mm-hmm. strike of 18 happened, she saw nothing, heard nothing. She never went near a microphone.
Right, right. She just wanted a job. She just was happy to have a job
and a position. It was the teachers' unions that put her there.
Yeah, sure. Oh, I know.
We saw the whole thing in the indictment of her in Fount Holland.
I was at KFAQ when she first ran,
mm-hmm.
and we interviewed her, mm-hmm. and I saw that she was an empty shirt,
mm-hmm.
empty suit, whatever you mm-hmm. want to call it. And Pat and I sat there, and I went after her like a rabid dog, and we didn't, you know, she knew it. She didn't like me. I didn't like her from day
mm-hmm.
one.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Pat was kind of being a referee. Mm-hmm. But no, I mean, I knew she was bad news from the beginning. I knew she was a fake, a phony. She pretended to be a Republican, but she was nothing more than a rhino to the nth degree. So,
yeah.
Hey, so, oh, yeah, there's a new plan to attack gun rights in Congress.
Mm.
Yeah, this is interesting. It's a newly proposed bill that plots a novel attack on America's gun rights. Okay. There are two senators, that position their gas-operated semi-automatic firearms exclusion act. It's called Go Safe, which basically is an acronym.
Is this for the kind that uses a CO2 cartridge?
No. The way it works, because see, basically the way they're going around this gas-operated semi-automatic, every firearm, every semi-automatic, it cocks because of discharge of the gas when the bullet is expended.
Yeah, the explosion.
Right,
yeah.
The explosion. So basically, that's what they... So it was introduced in late November. It would regulate the sale, transfer, and manufacturing of gas-operated semi-automatic weapons. Basically, every gun you own, essentially.
Oh, okay. See, when you say gas, I went to the CO2 cartridge.
Right, but no. Because every gun you have, essentially, emits gas when you fire, and that gas is what cocks it.
Yeah.
So that's what this is. They're trying to be tricky.
Yeah.
That's what this is. It's a scam. It's a scam is what they're trying to pull. Fool somebody. But anyway, so it introduced in late November would regulate the sale, transfer, manufacture of gas-operated semi-automatic weapons as regulations on especially dangerous mechanical features, according to the press release. The distinction allows them to pitch the legislation as a way to promote safety while also protecting constitutional rights to own firearms for self-defense, hunting, sporting purposes. But opponents of the bill say it still infringes on the Second Amendment. Senate Republicans blocked Democrats' bid Wednesday to introduce the assault weapons ban in 94, which expired after 10 years. Dianne Feinstein, California's assault weapons ban in 2013, said in an interview with the AP this week that his intent... Oh, Heinrich, who voted against renewing the Democrat... Dianne Feinstein, I was going to say Dianne Feinstein, wait a minute, well, she left us, said in an interview this week that his intent with the latest legislation was to figure out how to create a regulatory structure that is not focused on the individual firearm model, but on the mechanical properties that make these things dangerous. Well, basically exactly. The thing that makes it dangerous is the fact that it cocks.
It recoils.
So they're trying all kinds of ways to get around. And
you know, when you first talked about, I actually thought they were going for a different twist, that they were going to go on ecological issues, that it's causing a pollution.
Oh no! Yeah,
I got exhaust.
I
I could see them trying that number. You got to save the earth, you know. These things are going to destroy the earth.
Yeah,
you know?
But how many gas operate? I mean, how many shots are fired every year? Well, you know?
But they will, if you look at, we've talked about the wetlands, you know, the number one creator of methane is not the cow farts.
Right.
It's not the gas stove in your kitchen.
It's wetlands.
It's the swamps. And we must save the wetlands.
We can't call them
swamps anymore because they're wetlands. Yeah. They're sacred. They're pristine. They're, you know, back to nature.
Let me ask you a question.
And they're producing methane.
Let me ask you a question. What do you think drives these people? Motivates
control.
Them?
It's all about control.
But what? I mean, what are they trying to control? What would motivate people essentially to destroy mankind? Because that's really what their ideas are doing.
It's biblical. It's the lust for power. And when you control other people, what they're allowed to do, how they're allowed to, that's a demonic thing. Liberty is something Jesus came to promote, to preach. I come to proclaim liberty.
So it's not that they're deluded. They're basically evil.
They don't realize how demonically they're influenced.
So you think some of them are then deluded in their thinking, and it's just...
Oh, yeah. And remember the famous C.S. Lewis quote about the moral busybody is worse than the tyrant. Because the tyrant might grow weary of his tyrannies and his abuses, but the moral busybody will never be tired because he's affirmed of his own conscience that what he's doing to you is for your own good. And it's not just a liberal thing. I can think of some Republican district attorneys who think they're doing you a favor, locking you up for 5 years for that bottle of cannabis, CBD oil. Because that's 8 years ago. Yeah. It was a 5-year prison sentence for CBD oil.
Well, you remember, what was her name? That girl that got 13 years. She had like less than an ounce of marijuana. They finally pardoned her.
Yeah.
But it was ridiculous, you know.
Yeah, but I mean, people you and I generally respect in many ways as prosecutors, I still have this mindset of I'm doing you a favor by prosecuting. They're the ones that didn't want small possession of marijuana to be made a misdemeanor because they wanted it to be a felony so they could use it as leverage to get you to clean up your life. But they really didn't look at...
Even though when they put you into hard time,
yeah,
you're going to be exposed to hard criminals, which are going to make you a hardened criminal.
I literally have a meme of a nasty, mean-looking cop saying, drugs will destroy your life, so if I catch you with him, I will lock you up and destroy your life.
I will lock you and destroy your life. That's funny. Yeah, that's true. But, these people have to be deluded in their thinking. And the sad thing, though, to me is you have so many people in churches, in churches that whose minds are messed up. That's the sad thing. That will sit there and vote for Biden, vote for the Democrats because of some minute, you know, it's the old swallowing camels and gagging at gnats. They're gagging at gnats. But yet swallowing the camels, they're being fed by the Democrats. And they don't see.
No.
They don't see it.
Oh, yeah. Look, we Christians, we do this all the time. We lose perspective of what's important. I've been on pastoral staff meetings where we did more gossiping. But boy, if anybody is caught using a, quote, vulgar word, out the door.
Yeah.
Now, who's not controlling their tongue? You know what I'm saying?
I remember Keith Green back back in the early 80s where he said, you know, he was doing things. He said, you know, yesterday, 30,000 kids died of starvation. Today, 30,000 children will die of starvation. Tomorrow, 30,000 children will die of starvation. And you know what's really sad is that most of you out there don't give a damn. And he said, but you know what's worse? There are more people out there right now upset that I use the word damn than there are 90,000 children died in 3 days. And, you know, anyway, because that was, you know, he was talking about that the Christians now, damn, is everybody's using that now, you know, that we're way beyond that now. Right. But this was like, you know, in like 80, 81 or 82, I guess. But the fact that he exposed something like what you're saying, that Christians, or it's when this Richard Roberts back, just before he got a divorce from Patty back in the year, there was an article in CCM, a Contemporary Christian Music Magazine, and he told his story about this pastor. Did we talk about this? Where he's in a meeting with his deacons and saying, guys, I don't know what to do. He said, my life at home is horrible. I can't live with my wife anymore, but I can't divorce her because... the flock, the people, they won't understand.
You'll lose his career.
Yeah. And one of the elders or deacons said, he said, I don't know what to do. He said, kill her. He said, what? He said, yes, kill her. He said, they'll forgive you for murder, but they'll never forgive you for divorce.
Yeah.
But, you know, and it was an extreme joke, but in a sense, you know, it brought home the point that we're ready to forgive murderers mm-hmm. in the church. You know, mm-hmm. we forgive murderers, drug addicts, prostitutes. Mm-hmm. We forgive the people that commit these horrible crimes when they give their lives to the Lord. But divorce,
yeah.
you know, it used to be, you know, now I think we've gone too far the other way where divorce is just seen as we've gone too lenient on, made it too easy to divorce.
Right.
But back then there were circumstances where divorces were warranted for the sake of children, for the sake of whatever. But yet at the same, you had to wear the Scarlet D or whatever, you know, mm-hmm. but this is how we are. This is how, I guess we will always be. It's just the pharisaical attitudes, the this, the that, you know. And it's sad that we can't, as a body, begin having a more, I don't know, just a better, a broader and a clearer vision of the things that are important, the camels versus the gnats.
That's what I was going to say. Jesus said, you swallow a camel, yet screen at a gnat.
Yeah.
That's where that reference comes from. That's Jesus. So it tells me it's always been an issue with religious people is because we allow groupthink to control our behavior more than renewing our mind to the word of God. Again, renewing our mind daily to the word of God. Think for yourself. Don't allow somebody else to establish what your moral convictions are.
Yep.
It's between you and God. Some moral convictions are meant to be individually designed by fellowship with God and God giving you direction, renewing your life. You know, things that you thought were okay 10 years ago might not be okay today because of your Christian growth. It's called purifying our lives, you know, and this is, it's.
You know, that's something interesting because I do this seminar on discipleship. And a part of it, I talk about how you're familiar with mores, right? Social mores.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. And sin is sin, mm-hmm. but mores are mores. Mm-hmm. So for example, I always use the example of swimsuits.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You mean there isn't scripture to tell us which swimsuits are okay?
Exactly.
Okay.
And so I talk about how, you know, the most modest swimsuits women wear today would have gotten them arrested in 1900.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
Remember, they used to wear them down to their ankles and up to, you know, the full body suits that women and guys used to wear, the full swimsuits. And now, you know, the swimsuits, the bikinis, the thongs, everything, you know. And so it's just interesting that lust is, but at the same time, men could lust after a woman in one of those full, you know, you would still lust, even though, and today.
Hey, I mean, look, we have yoga pants out there today, right?
Yes, exactly. Yoga pants.
It's no different than what the garb they were wearing a century ago.
Yeah, bicycle pants, you know, all these different things, halter tops, you know. In fact, when I got saved, the girls, my wife even, was wearing halter tops.
Mm-hmm.
But it was funny because the halter tops were not seductive. It didn't, you know, it was just what they wore, you know what I mean? And so, but I'm just saying, so it's like the social mores change, but lust doesn't. So it's not necessarily what you wear, it's how you wear it.
Yeah.
It's how you wear it. And I talk to the girls, I always tell them, you know, the girls know when they're wearing, what they're wearing, and what they're wearing it for.
Oh, yeah. They're not as dumb as they like.
Exactly. What the intent is when they're wearing it. Mm-hmm. Am I out there to catch a guy? And it's funny because I teach it to, like, teenagers or younger, and you see them go, you know, doing a little, giggling, smirking, you know. And you know, you got some goofy guys. That's a funny one. But it just shows through the ages, the difference, same with money, you know, how you handle money. It's not the amount you steal. It's that you steal. Mm-hmm. It's not the amount you cheated someone out of. It's that you cheated someone. It's all about the intent,
yeah,
and the motive and how and why and the amount of hurt, you know. Mm-hmm. But it's so funny how we can try to excuse. Like I remember before I got saved, before I became a Christian, I knew I was bad. And I would tell God, I know I'm bad. Mm-hmm. You know, I know this is wrong, but I'm not like him.
Oh yeah, there's always somebody who's the worst.
Exactly. I would say, I know, God, I know I'm bad, but I'm not like him. Yeah. You know, and I'm glad I'm not like
my him. Sins aren't as bad as that man's sins.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, until you get saved, then you realize, oh, I'm bad. I'm really bad. Yeah. You know, and that's the beauty of encountering Christ when you mm-hmm. finally face the fact that I'm bad. Mm-hmm. You know, I deserve to go right. to hell, or I deserve punishment, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And I need you. You know, I mm-hmm. need you, Lord. I can't make it without you. I can't be delivered without you. So anyway, but anyway, these are just, we've got another whole show. We can do another whole show. One of these days, we need to just do a show like that.
I have to say, Debbie and I, when we were dating, it wasn't long before we were married, she actually was with me at the church where I was on staff, and I had to drop off a couple of the students. And we were in downtown Minneapolis, and it was a very warm late May. And there was a gal at one street corner. She was dressed very seductively. And I said to Debbie, I said, you know, if a girl doesn't feel like she can be pretty enough, she settles for being sexy as a substitute for just being pretty. And I see that a lot. It's just like, if my looks aren't enough, then I will settle for sexuality to somehow substitute, because they're just starving for attention. They're, right. they're looking for love.
And even the beautiful ones, even the prettiest ones that do the sex, it's like, it's not enough to be the prettiest one. I want to be the prettiest and the sexiest, or I want to be the sexiest and the, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
because there's always someone you're competing with.
Yeah, and if you don't have contentment in your life.
Exactly, exactly.
And contentment is one of those virtues God gives.
It's the same with money.
Yeah.
It's the same with money.
Yeah.
I mean, one thing, I just am so thankful that money has never been a hang up for me. I've never wanted to be rich. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm sorry. I've wanted to be rich. I wouldn't mind being rich. Okay? Mm-hmm. But it's not something I've lusted after. I've given my life.
Yeah, you're not obsessed.
I'm not obsessed with being rich. I'm thankful for what I get. Mm-hmm. You know, Lord, if you want to bless me, hey, okay, I'm here. Mm-hmm. But I'm not out to, you know, because I know people, friends and others that, man, they're just slaving, always trying to make more, 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 more. Mm-hmm. And now, I mean, and I have had a wonderful life just... Yeah. In fact, I remember before I got married young, when I was a young Christian, and I said, God, you know, I'd be happy if you can just give me a place to stay, a bed and food, mm-hmm. you know, and let me serve you. I'll be happy. That's all I want. That's all I need.
Yeah.
You know, and he's done that and much, much more, you know. So that's kind of been my attitude, and I've been blessed.
The other thing I wanted to say to drive home, you know, elaborate on the point you're making, in the epistles, especially the Apostle Paul, gives us a lot of instruction, not just about what is sin, but also about convictions and how Paul gives us a formula. It's not about what you have a right to do. It's really what is more advantageous, not just to you, but to your brother and sister in Christ. Right. You know, he says, yes, I have a right to do this, but if it's going to cause a brother to stumble, then I give it up.
Yeah.
Because the important thing is the soul of my brother, that I don't want to create an opportunity for him that he might not be able to handle.
Yeah.
You know, and as a strong Christian, if you think you're a strong Christian, what comes with that is a duty to bear up the weak and the baby Christians and the people who are still having to struggle with it. Don't become the obstacle keeping from somebody from Christ.
Yeah.
You know, and so he says, look, some of these things, they're totally allowable, but because somebody else has a problem with it. Now, he's not calling for groupthink, that you somehow adopt somebody else's false beliefs. You just say, you know, I don't have a conviction personally, it's wrong, but I do have a conviction that I should not offend you.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah. That's where I'm at on it.
Yep. Hey, in the future, very near future, we need to do a show, or at least part of a show, on replacement theology.
Oh.
I think it's a very relevant subject right now. Are you familiar with replacement theology?
I've heard the term. Help us all okay. up here with tease us.
Well, first, I want it's relevant because of Israel and the attacks, Hamas and Palestine. Replacement theology essentially says that Christians, believers in Christ, now have replaced the Jews as God's chosen people. Mm-hmm. So the promises in the Old Testament to God to the Jews as God's chosen are now to Christians, and essentially he's cast the Jews aside. Mm. That's replacement theology. Basically, that we have replaced.
Didn't the Muslims do that too? They basically adopted that philosophical.
Well, see, that's what I'm afraid is that's where I don't want to get too deep into it, but yeah, basically, that's exactly it, that a lot of Christians now are buying into this, that essentially God is done with the Jews. They're no longer his chosen, that we are his chosen, and the Muslims essentially can get rid of them. But I don't want to get too...
No. I've got just a little bit of insight that by the way of an analogy.
Well, hold on to that.
Okay.
Okay? All right. Because okay. If you get going, I'll have to count it. We'll keep going.
You're right.
Hey, so hopefully we have whetted your appetite.
Hey, I understand. Now, we're going to be out of pocket, maybe be doing some remote things.
Because that's holiday time.
Right. I understand you've got opportunities to get together with some people. And you also did last weekend. We haven't.
Yeah, we didn't even talk about it. I was in St. Louis last weekend and by myself. I went up a nice little 6-hour drive up and back.
It's a long drive.
Yeah.
Boring.
But I like to drive.
What so. For? Why'd you go?
It was a black conservative meeting, which is kind of interesting. I went up to support my friend Kareem Abdul Haq. Mm. He's a Muslim.
Okay.
But he's a conservative Muslim who I think he's probably closer to Christian than, he's a really interesting guy. He's an economist as well.
Okay.
But he's a very conservative black. Mm-hmm. He's not a Nation of Islam Muslim. He's more of a traditional Muslim.
Sure.
And, but we get along real well. We see things eye to eye, but he's like very, very conservative.
So he had a gathering of some sort.
Excuse me.
Yeah, he had a gathering with conservatives. Excuse me. Speakers, panelists.
Okay.
And then he had a talent show and all that.
Okay.
I came up and
one day
I had my book. I brought my book and signed my book. But anyway, no, it was a good time. There was one gentleman who was not a conservative on the panel, and he was a typical angry black man that wanted to blame the white man and Republicans on everything. And the rest of the panelists went after him. Oh, one of the panelists.
Well, that makes it fun. You got to have a goat.
Yeah. But one of the interesting things was one of the panelists was the great granddaughter of Dred Scott.
Oh, the famous Supreme Court decision.
The Dred Scott.
The non-human.
Yeah, that basically enshrined slavery.
Yes, by the U.S. Supreme Court, which was followed just a few years later by a civil war.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah, the Dred Scott decision basically said that even a runaway slave, that they could go get him, bring him back and everything. But yeah, it essentially ended up in a civil war. But his great-granddaughter, so now... I have met and become friends with Booker T. Washington's great.
Yeah, calendar. A lot of these great black leaders in society, really, they have more conservative roots about them.
Yeah, it's interesting because Frederick Douglass's posterity, mm-hmm. they're conservative. Mm-hmm. Booker T. Washington, Dred Scott. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's really, really pretty amazing. Whereas the latter ones from this, not mm-hmm. this century, but the latter, we're talking 2 centuries, the true ones that suffered and went through the actual discrimination and actual slavery, they're all conservative. Mm-hmm. But then you have the ones that have come through the civil rights. They're all the angry ones.
Yeah.
Like Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, and some of those. In fact, I think
Malcolm X, remember he said the...
No, I'm not talking about Malcolm X. I'm talking about the offspring.
Right. Yeah. No, I get that. And the Farrakhans, you know. But Malcolm X, he said the most dangerous person to our movement is the white liberal.
Right. Right. But I'm speaking offspring right now
of
these...
Yeah.
More modern people
right.
are all more liberal.
Yeah.
And, although if you take Martin Luther King Jr.'s niece.
Yeah. Alveda.
She's very conservative.
Yeah. And you and her have worked together and things.
Yeah. Although she's not very happy with me because my chapter in my book about her uncle.
Yeah.
Her daddy was assassinated as well.
Oh,
that's an untold story. Yeah.
Yeah, yes.
Man, we could do another show, 2 shows.
But I think you've got high regard for what Alveda has stood for publicly.
Oh, yeah. No, totally. Totally. Yeah. And listen, I'm not, I don't go after Martin Luther King Jr. in what he sought to do and, in a sense, did. I'm more upset what he has been made into and projected as, which I believe is not legitimate.
Oh, okay. So it's not a personal attack on him.
No.
It's
no.
The revisionist history.
Exactly. Yeah. Of who he is and what he was and so forth. That's the thing that gets me. Because I believe, honestly speaking, I have in some ways a higher regard for the purity of Malcolm X, even though he was this black, known as this black militant Muslim, than I do for Martin Luther King Jr.
Yeah, well,
which really puts me at odds with a whole lot of conservatives.
But see, the way people perceive Malcolm X today could be a revisionist history, too.
Yeah, oh, no, I agree. If anybody ever, Alex Haley, wrote Roots.
Yeah.
He did the autobiography of Malcolm X. He wrote the book.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. If you get a chance, read the first half of the book. It's funny. I read the first half of the book before I became a Christian. I put it down and didn't read it for like 6 months, almost a year. Mm. Then I got saved. Mm. And for some reason, I decided to pick it back up and read the second half. Mm. And it was like, wow, it was a whole different thing.
Your eyes were open.
Yeah. But that's where he converted to Islam, where he came out of prison and he converted to Islam.
Yeah.
But I read him and his conversion with whole different eyes. And I saw what he went through, how he left the Nation of Islam. He saw Elijah Muhammad, the founder at the time, in a whole new way, that he was a charlatan and just basically a crook. And he saw him in a whole different way, and they got into it, and then he left, and he didn't see white people as his enemy any longer, and I believe, here's what I believe he was truly seeking, and I believe had he lived long enough, he very likely would have come to a realization that Christianity, and he said one of the most profound things I've ever heard. He used to debate Yale students in Massachusetts. Connecticut. Where is it?
Hartford, is it? No.
Is it Hartford or South? No, not Hartford. It's one of the coastal cities. I can't remember the name of it. Anyway, it's in Connecticut. But anyway, and he used to debate them. Mm-hmm. They would come to his prison. He was in prison in Connecticut, mm-hmm. and these Yale students would come. Mm-hmm. And while he was there, He wrote in his book very clearly, he said, the only thing wrong with Christianity, now get this, he said, there's nothing wrong with Christianity except that the followers have never lived up to the teaching of its founder.
Yeah.
In other words, basically that Christians have not lived up to the teachings of Christ.
Yeah.
And which is true.
Sure.
Because we're all sinned and come short of the glory of God.
Yeah, we believe in grace.
Right. And so, but he never had an opportunity to be shown that. Mm-hmm. And then he was killed, you know, he was murdered.
Yeah.
By Elijah Muhammad's people.
So, well, good. So that answers what you did last weekend.
That's what I did last week.
It was a great opportunity.
Yeah, yeah. So anyway, yeah, but we'll be doing some, we're going to take a little Christmas break.
Yeah.
And we'll do some remote stuff.
Yeah.
Which should be fun. Yeah. Test out all your new equipment.
I do, yeah.
And all of our stuff. So stay tuned. We still need to do, Dave and I want to do a Christian oldies show where we play nothing but like these greatest hits of Christian music.
You know what? I think we get both our laptops. I know you're running over to see some friends in another town at some point. And maybe we just, you know, put up our playlists and we can do that remote where we can actually, you know, give a little sample of some of the songs that have been impacting in our lives.
Yeah.
And I think you're going to be getting together with
Here or there, wherever we should do that.
Songwriter friends you're going to be getting with?
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see.
Oh, yeah. Just teasing it. We'll see what happens.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, folks.
All right. Yep, 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 yep. Yep. That's all, folks.
Looks like stormy weather forever. And they'll never see the light of day. All in silence, kids don't sing. Their deliverer was on the way. For they knew with God, all they were protected. For they knew with God, honor, safety. For they knew with God, God's your heart, we shall come.
Oh, recording in progress. Okay.
Yeah.
I better behave.
Turn my volume.
Let me see. Make sure all of the mics are up. Our sound effect is up. And when you say go, I will hit the record button. Mm-hmm. These are all up. Levels are up.
This actually isn't the most crisp with that webcam.
The webcam is not the most crisp, but it is crisp.
No, it's not. I think our other camera is a little more crisp.
This looks pretty. The webcam looks pretty crisp, but nevertheless.
It blends our wrinkles, right?
We have three cameras going today, everyone. Yes. Three cameras. Count them. One, two, three. By the way, you know, in Europe, Germans, okay, they count like this. One, two, three. So a lot of times, if you're somewhere and say, how many do you want? You'll go. And it's, two.
Oh.
No, three.
Yeah,
in fact, if you saw, what was that movie? Dirty Rotten Bastards or something.
Hmm.
Was that the name of it? With Brad Pitt. And they went behind enemy lines. And they were in Germany during the war. Anyway, they got outed. They went to a German Gasthaus,
mm-hmm.
a pub.
Mm-hmm.
And they were in there. And the waiter or waitress, somebody, how many more? And the guy went like this. He wanted three. And that's how the Germans found out that they weren't German because, oh, I'm sorry, they did this. They did this.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he went like this or this. This is how Americans would do it, like this, or even, you know, in baseball or in sport, strike three.
So this is.
This is in Europe. This is how you count three.
Not just Germany, but a few other.
Yeah, probably. Yeah. I think so. But, you know, in Germany, it's like that. And that's how the Germans found out that they weren't German because they did this or they did this. And then they it started a big shootout and almost everybody in the whole Gashtube got killed just because of that one little mistake. See, with me, I'm so used to doing this with the thumb. The thumb counts as one.
Yeah.
One, two, three.
Well, you're a native German.
I am a, German native.
And a native German. See, I'm
a native.
I am a Native American of European tribal descent.
Okay, that's a mouthful, but okay.
Well, but I'm still Native American. Native American just says I was born here.
Right, but truly a Native, in the modern definition, a Native American is an American Native.
I am fighting it.
You're fighting it?
Our government does not use the term Native American other than our Constitution says you have to be Native-born American.
Native-born American.
Right, but in all government documents, the tribes referred to as American Indian.
Right. And actually, if you want to be more precise, it would be Aboriginal.
Yeah.
The Aboriginal Americans, like Australian Aborigines or Aboriginals, are in Africa, it's the Hottentots in South Africa, like the gods must be crazy.
Oh, yes, yeah. Yes.
Those are the Aboriginal Africans.
Yeah. And folks, if you have not seen the movie, The Gods Must Be Crazy.
You must be crazy.
You're not a boomer.
A boomer, yeah. Oh, I see.
The door.
Yeah.
And I'll turn the screen.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, that is a classic. Gods Must Be Crazy. That was the 80s.
A low budget hit.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It took the world by storm. And it's so funny, low budget. I mean, you talk about low budget. I mean, there were three characters in the whole movie, if you don't count the animals.
Okay.
What was the main? It was a warthog. Mm-hmm. A warthog and maybe an ostrich made a cameo.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was pretty crazy. That guy was a little the one... Hottentot, which we know is what do they call them? There's another name for the Hottentots. The tribe from the original native to South Africa. I cannot think of their name right now, but they're a lighter skinned African people, and they're not the Bushmen there because they're not bush. It's more of a desert area, and they walk around. They're a lot like the Aborigines in Australia because they learn to live on very little water. They hide ostrich eggs filled with water and things underground. And they just know they've learned how to survive.
Madagascar's a lot like that, isn't it?
Is it? I don't know.
My understanding is the tribes of Madagascar. It's a very arid climate is what I've heard.
Yeah. But I wish I could remember the name of what they call those people, but they were Hottentots, which you know, you always, when you tune into Fresh Black Coffee, you're going to get some fresh, not always black coffee. because the Hottentots are a lighter skin. They're lighter than me. They're a very lighter skin people, but they were originally the original Aboriginals of South Africa. And when the Dutch and British came, they cohabited with them and everything was cool.
Yeah.
But then Shaka Zulu, the Zulu Shaka, who black African Americans like to champion, he came from Central Africa, and the Bantus is what they're classified as, the darker skinned Central African blacks. The Bantus Shaka took them and started marching south, and he would kill or capture these tribes. You either join me or die. That's what Shaka did. And he massed his 300,000 member army as they marched south.
So they were outside conquerors.
Yes.
So these majority tribes who claim to be the rightful inhabitants and rulers of South Africa are just carpetbaggers that come in and on conquest.
Counterfeits. Fakers.
Yeah. You know, because you could say that about the, quote, civilized tribes of Oklahoma that are imported.
Hello.
You know, and the tribes who lived here, especially out in Okarchi and Apache, you know, and a bunch of those.
Preach it. Preach it. Preach it.
So
the whole world may know.
So it isn't just the white folk who immigrate to other countries and by conquest take.
No, and what's so sad is that Black Americans, and not only Americans, in mm-hmm. Britain, every country that they've mm-hmm. managed to be brought to, mm-hmm. the transposed Black folks mm-hmm. have now perpetrated this myth that the entire continent of Africa was theirs and they were invaded and they were stolen from that land, et cetera, when mm-hmm. in South, particularly what's really bad is in South Africa, they have essentially taken over South Africa now when they actually were the invaders of South Africa.
Yeah.
Because they took it away from the Hottentots.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, and this happened growing up in Minnesota. One thing I did learn about the history of the tribes that were there before the European, mm-hmm. you know, ethnics came. The French.
Guess what, Dave?
Oh.
Oh, wait. You know what? What's that? Are you sure you would like
to? Oh, the formatting. You forgot to.
No, I did. I did format it.
Okay.
But it won't. Are you sure you would like to format? Yes. It won't record. That's what happened. I pushed it, but it won't record.
Yeah, it's blue.
Is there?
The card's in.
Excuse us, ladies and gentlemen, but we have.
We never.
Houston.
This is still our pre-show.
But the people are. The Facebook people. Is that recording on Facebook?
Yeah.
You Facebook are really getting some history and some info now. It won't. Okay, I'm going to say no. It still won't.
Let me take it
out. Yeah, we better get another card.
I can just take it out and put it back in and see if that.
Ah.
Now it's green.
Now.
I had to touch the second time.
Yeah, okay.
Let's hit record.
All right, here we go.
Yeah.
So, in other words, again, the Zulu were Bantu.
Oh, okay.
The Bantus is a name for all of the darker skinned Black Central African
from the jungle regions,
right?
Yeah,
the darkest Africa,
Angola.
Well, no, Angola is West Africa. Okay.
Oh, that's right. That's
right. West Africa. Yeah.
Zaire.
Yeah, the Congo. Uganda. What's just north? More Nigeria would still be up in there.
Mm-hmm.
Sudan. Mm-hmm. All of that, but that's more central. The CAR, yeah. Central African Republic. All of those areas, and so Shaka, who is a Black hero. For some reason, even though he murdered hundreds of thousands of his fellow African tribesmen.
Mm-hmm.
And as he marched down to South Africa, and actually what's funny is the Dutch and British mm-hmm. arrived in South Africa before Shaka, before the Zulu. So they were actually there. So anybody, and this is what's so funny about this reconciliation stuff, because the South Africans for some reason had these big ceremonies where they were doing foot washings and mm-hmm. you know, mea culpas, forgive us for all we did to you people. And yes, there was apartheid was not good. Okay, that was bad. Okay, but at the same time, the Zulus have never apologized to any of the others. And you have the Zulus, the Khoza, they're the ones with the clicking. They click their throats, when they talk click. Mm-hmm. You have the Zulus, the Xhosa, there's a couple other tribes all down in there. And, you know, it's this tribal warfare, but basically all the black tribes were not there. It was the hotshots in South Africa. And then the Europeans came, and then the Bantu came later. So anyway, a little bit of history.
What I was saying is what I was taught in high school in Minnesota, in junior high, the original tribes of Minnesota, the Ojibwe or Chippewas, were actually more from Michigan, especially Upper Peninsula, and Wisconsin. And the Dakota Sioux, Sioux is a derogatory term that the Chippewas made for the Dakotas. It means dog.
Really?
Yes, they call it dog.
Okay, so, I can't think of his name. What is the band? The Lakota.
Yeah.
The Lakota.
Which is a part of
the Dakotas, right, which is what Crazy Horse was, yes. Mm-hmm. And Sitting Bull.
Right.
So they call them Sioux, but they were really Dakotas and Lakotas. Yeah.
What happened is the French traders, you know, kids in school are not taught enough about the French origins of America. You know, we're taught about New England.
Right.
And we're told the story centric.
And the Southwest.
Yeah.
The Spanish.
Right. Yeah.
The Spanish.
Oh, my goodness. The Spaniards had so developed, like Santa Fe. Big Spanish outpost. Mm-hmm. And then all along the California coast,
all the way out west,
the Spaniards had developed. You know, it's not like, you know, we sent Lewis and Clark.
Lost this and lost that and sand this and sand that, right?
Right.
All the way up the coast, lost and sand.
You know, we act like we didn't know was there until Lewis and Clark went to this pristine virgin place that nobody, the French were waiting for them in the upper Mississippi, and the Spaniards were waiting for them in L.A. Yeah. You know? And yes, it was Los Angeles, which is a Spanish name. But what I'm saying is the French had done a better job of building relationships as traders with the Eastern tribes, right? Including the Choctaw, who's, Greenwood LaFleur,
from Mississippi.
Yeah, the slave owner.
Right. Who Greenwood District is named after.
Yeah. His father was a Frenchman. He's half French, and yet was the principal chief of the Choctaws.
And the black area, Greenwood District, is named after.
Yeah.
But they changed Brady District.
But we'll have a slave owner from Greenwood, Mississippi, Jefferson Davis.
You know that Greenwood LaFleur's, any information about him has been wiped from Wikipedia. You can't find it.
Oh, my goodness. That's crazy. Because I'm going to make sure I hang on to my blog post.
Yeah.
Because I documented all
this. Oh, no, that's good.
And so, but what happened is with the help of the French, the Sioux were run out of Minnesota. Now, again, they're the Dakota tribe. I only reference because you've heard of them as Sioux. Sioux is an Ojibwe term for a dog. But this is what, you know, we act like, the rightful owners of Minnesota are the Ojibwe. No, you know, they came in and ran out the tribes that were there, you know. And so it's what did
Well, see, that's what I talk about in my book, which has two versions.
Yeah.
It's the same book, just two different covers. But anyway, people want to feel sorry for the Native Americans.
Yeah.
We want to feel sorry for the Hispanics, the Mexicans, the South Americans, etc. Don't feel sorry for them.
Yes.
The things they were doing to each other before Columbus ever arrived probably make with the Europeans pale in comparison. You know, the human sacrifices and burying people up to their necks and pouring molasses and letting ants eat them, you know, stuff like this. Now, Europeans, they were pretty, you know, Albania, some of the stories crucifying people. I mean, every tribe and nation and tongue is guilty of barbarism.
Yeah, okay, it's conquest.
It's conquest, but the horror that they can put people through.
Oh yeah,
it's almost like this is no joke. This is like fraternities. Okay, it's human nature. They've done studies. There's this famous study they did. I learned about it when I was taking management in college. And they took the, and they made a movie about it, and they took a group of kids and they put them together in a study, and they divided one half into prison guards and the other half as inmates. And they left them alone for, I don't know, it was a week, 2 weeks or whatever. But after a certain amount of time, the guards took on the behavior of true prison guards and the inmates of inmates. Yeah. And it kind of got out of hand.
Wow.
Yeah. And their personality started changing. The guards started abusing the others. And I was the dean of pledges in my fraternity. Oh, wow. And I found myself about halfway through the things we were putting them through were getting crazier and crazier and crazier.
Yeah.
Until one night I did something, and when I got a few hours later, I realized this is dangerous. These guys could be killed.
Yeah.
And I decided to get everybody, we better go back and rescue these guys before somebody dies and we're in real trouble. More fortunately, these guys were really sharp young men. And they got themselves out of it. And and we found them walking down the road, happy singing. And I was, you know, I was off the hook. But in your mind, for some reason, we just go that way. And that's what I think happens to people in power.
Yeah.
After a while, this is not enough anymore.
Yeah.
A little bit more. And we got to exert a little more power and a little more power. And then at some point, somebody down here says, enough. Mm-hmm. And then they fight back. But then the people with the power decide that they have got to fight it.
Yeah.
And fight back. And you can't do that. So anyway, man, I don't know how we got off on this.
But I think, it's fine. Oh, I can just move it so I could open another browser.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. I just want to be sure.
Yeah. No, it's.
Oh,
it's,
there you are. Okay.
Yeah. So, but you know, this is the deceptiveness. And I think in many ways, one of the wisest Americans we've had on the issue of government is Thomas Jefferson, because, you know, he was aware of the need to be vigilant about retaining liberty as an individual. You know, I think, wasn't it Jefferson who said the duty of a patriot is to protect his people from their government? You know, somebody once said a war is when the government tells you who the enemy is. A revolution is when you figure it out for yourself.
That's a great one. Yeah.
Yeah.
And de Tocqueville, when he came, the Frenchman who came and saw, he said our democracy can't survive because once those in power figure out that they can dictate, use that to their own advantage, they're going to dictate it to their advantage.
Yeah, the great debates between Hobbes and Locke about this, because Hobbes being a statist, and the statist mindset is, I always say, just a little more power and control and we'll have society's ills fixed. And I think of Justin Trudeau like that. And what Canada, you know, people started revolting against government going too far. And well, we've got to stamp this out. Macron's the same way, you know, and they just, well, it's just a little more, you know, what was it? My son gave me a t-shirt for Christmas last year. Statist. It says, idea is so good, they must be imposed on everybody. It's so good. Why do you have to force people into it?
Right, right. And it's and the sad thing is that too many people don't understand that.
Yeah.
And it's funny because it's not the so-called ignorant or what we call uneducated that get it or that don't get it. It's the so-called educated class.
Oh, yeah.
It's what the Bible calls the wise fools.
Yes.
You know, the wise have become fools.
Yeah.
And it's crazy because the common man has common sense to understand, wait a minute, I just want to be free to live my life.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, a long time ago, it's like the Lord gave me a vision of what political, or we would call it theater, but political warfare is like. And it's like in the old medieval times, you've got two towers.
Yeah.
And you got the town, and one side of town, you've got a tower here and a tower here. And these guys are shooting catapults with flaming balls going in and arrows flying across and shooting at each other. Mm-hmm. And down below, you've got the common people.
The hospital in Gaza?
Yeah, going to market. You got the people just going to market, going about their business every day. And this war is going on up here, you know, and these people don't even realize what's going on, but they're being taxed and they're paying for the guy's ammo up there, you know, and the arrows and the guys to fight and these guys here to fight these guys. And they're just fighting away. And down here, everybody's just
living, paying the bills for you to keep doing
and
it
and living their lives.
Yeah.
But that's kind of this vision I had of what's really going on between the Democrats and Republicans and the left and the right. And the
it's gang warfare.
Yeah.
It's just gangs.
And it's now as polarized internationally.
Yeah.
It's the same thing you have, you know, between NATO and the Eastern Bloc.
Yeah, we actually have a globalist, anti-globalist movement. It's become global in its fight against globalism.
Right, right.
You know, all of a sudden, what we see in the last month, you know, Argentina, the Brazil, Bolivia, you know, Hungary, Denmark, right? Or Netherlands.
Yeah, Holland. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, Netherlands.
You know, and we've already seen in Italy in that there's this revolt, and then there's popular uprisings going on in Canada and in France. You know, it's amazing.
Yeah, yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Anyway, this is our pre-show show. Yeah. So maybe we should start with